Hello everyone.
Hello.
Yeah, so I'm Yogesh Joshi. I'm faculty of chemical engineering at IIT Kanpur. And I have this 3 hours of presentation on yield stress fluids, wherein we'll be discussing significant part of the presentation will be the experimental observations of various kinds of experimental observations of on these yield stress fluids. And followed by that, I'll be kind of discussing some of the modeling techniques and how various experimental observations have been successfully modeled, not quantitatively, qualitatively, but we'll essentially kind of discuss those aspects. All right. So what I'm going to do now is that I'm going to share my screen here, and you'll be able to hear my voice, and you'll be able to see the screen, and I'll be able to kind of highlight few points while talking to you. Having said that, I really want this to be as much as possible interactive. I know it's not that easy with Skype, but if you have any question, just feel free to stop me. Probably you'll have to come near to the mic of your Skype device. And just stop me anytime and ask me questions. All right. So I'll be very happy to answer any questions that you'll have. All right. So with this, let me share the screen now. Are you, yeah, has it been shared?
No.
If you are seeing yourself, then it is shared. Yeah, you can see yourself, right?
Yeah.
Okay, wonderful. Okay, so with this, let me go back to my presentation and start the same. Okay, so here we start. Pardon me?
You have to make it full screen.
Oh, just a moment.
Yeah.
Oh, you are seeing your own picture there, is that right?
Oh, well, we are seeing also the notes and slide, next slide, etc.
Is that right?
Yeah.
That's very strange actually, because I am seeing only the, let me first take care of the Skype part.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know what the problem is.
If you just do full screen, control L.
Yeah. Just a second. I am doing it. I need to get this is it all right?
Sir, go to display settings, sir.
Well, okay. Where are display settings? Is it all right now?
So I think so. Your screen is extended.
Oh, I see. Okay, wait a second.
Make a duplicate screen.
Yeah, I know, but let me see how to work it out. Yeah, I'm sorry for all these teething problems.
No problem.
So, can you quickly tell me how to do it? I used to know, but this Surface Pro is new, so I'm also kind of confused.
Yeah, just type display.
Okay.
Change display settings, the first one.
Okay, so is this the one?
Yeah, so where is duplicate? Scroll down, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
That's right.
That is.
Yes, then.
No, just no. Go up, back.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
That was
multiple. Duplicate this display.
Duplicate this display. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so,
we are fine.
Is this great now? Okay, fantastic. Only concern is, how should I? I should be able to do it myself, no? Just give me a second, I'm still some problem here. So are you seeing all the construction or you're directly seeing the presentation?
The earlier screen we had only the presentation, but right now we have also the next.
Yeah. Since actually I'm sharing the screen, okay, fair enough. Okay, let's do it in this way.
This is fine.
Okay, fine, fair enough. So I will have to use something else to change the slides. Okay, so we'll begin with overall experimental behavior of various kinds of yield stress fluids. But before that, I'm not sure how many of you have background in rheology. So I have some first 15-20 minutes. I'll be giving some brief on introduction to rheology, and then we'll start with our actual topic. To begin with, what is rheology? So rheology is the science of deformation and flow of matter. And in this particular subject, materials that are in fluid and semi-solid state are particularly studied. If you see the kind of definition of rheology, then everything that deforms or flows comes under rheology. But as a subject discipline, we primarily concentrate on fluids and semi-solids, which means that we concentrate on all those materials that have structure. So we essentially concentrate on structured fluids. In recent times, these structured fluids are also called as complex fluids. They're also called as, well, they're also known as soft materials. So any deformation and flow of soft materials is of primary concern to rheology. Its objective is to obtain a relationship, as much reliable relationship as one can find, between stress tensor and rate of strain tensor, or strain and its derivatives for a given material. So that is the primary objective. However, when the structured fluid is deformed, many complications arise, particularly because of the structural breakdown of the fluid due to deformation field. And therefore, coming up with the constitutive relationship is not that so easy. In general, particularly when worrying about the applications of soft materials, one has to really be concerned about the deformation field influences the structure, and then in turn essentially influences the deformation field itself. You will understand what I'm saying in the course of today's talk, because we are primarily going to talk about how the structured fluids break down under application of flow field, which essentially is yielding. And rheological study involves interrelation between structure and dynamics of these structured fluids. When it comes to understanding rheology of any material, as I said, our primary concern is understanding relationship between. Can you see my highlights also?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So our primary concern is to essentially get information about how stress is dependent on rate of strain tensor and the higher derivatives of strain. So this is our primary concern. However, What we essentially need along with a constitutive equation is equation of balance of mass, which is called, which we call continuity equation or mass balance equation, and momentum balance equation. Here what I am showing is angular momentum balance equation, and in this angular momentum balance equation we essentially have the first term is acceleration term, this term is momentum flux due to bulk flow, and this term is gravity term. All these three terms are very natural terms because they are very obvious terms. This particular term, on the other hand, is primarily because we consider continuum approximation, and particularly this stress tensor or momentum flux that essentially kind of arises due to diffusion. And since this is essentially derived, there is no natural relationship of stress and velocity field available in any kind of first principle. So we must guess the relationship between stress tensor and velocity and its gradients. So that is nothing but the constitutive relationship. So as far as primary understanding about constitutive relationship is concerned, what is usually done is that one observes the experimental behavior of material and comes with guesses as to how stress and rate of strain should be related to each other. The guess that works well, essentially you take that as constitutive relationship. So this happens to be the weakest link as far as any rheological analysis is concerned. Constitutive equations are such that they are not just viscous in nature, but they are also elastic in nature, and we'll come to that particular aspect later when we'll worry about the modeling aspects. Usually, it is sufficient for many systems of common interest. It is sufficient to consider generalized Newtonian behavior, which means that stress tensor is considered to be proportional to rate of strain tensor, with viscosity as a proportionality constant, and this particular viscosity is considered to be dependent on essentially either time or stress strain rate. And you essentially get generalized Newtonian. Why generalized? Because in strict Newtonian cases, viscosity is constant. Here, this gamma dot is nothing but the sum of velocity gradient and its trace, so that this gamma dot becomes a symmetric tensor, which is a requirement because of frame invariance. Okay, so as far as this talk is concerned, next kind of the 3 hours of talks are concerned, we are primarily concerned about shear flow field, and that also drag flow field. What is done in drag flow? You essentially have a stationary plate and you have a top plate. Everything in between is our material, and then top plate is moved either with constant velocity or with constant force, depending upon which mode of the flow field you are applying. So the velocity at any instance divided by the separation distance gives us the shear rate. On the other hand, force on the top plate divided by the area associated with the top plate gives us the shear stress. So this shear rate and this shear stress are of primary concern to us as far as the most fundamental aspects of rheology are concerned. As I said, that we'll be worrying primarily about shear flow field. So this is a very typical slide, although not complete in most aspects, as we will see in the course of these three lectures, that these are different types of flow behaviors. The bottom three are essentially fluids. The Newtonian is most common. If viscosity remains first constant and then with increase in shear rate it decreases, we get pseudoplastic. In some cases we'll get shear thickening behavior, which we'll see later. But these are usually the fluids. However, if material is in semi-solid state, then of course it needs to be provided some threshold stress in order to make it flow. So we have this Bingham plastic, which is weak shear thinning yield stress material. The Bingham plastic with strong shear thinning yield stress material, this is also known as Herschel-Berkeley model. So these are kinds of different types of models traditionally available with us. in the course of today's lectures, we'll also see that particularly how these two models are inadequate as far as modeling the behavior of yield stress materials are concerned. So just let's quickly go through some of the known systems. Newtonian fluid is the one where viscosity remains constant as a function of shear rate, and we know various materials that we come across in our day-to-day life. These are all Newtonian materials, water, alcohol, honey, glycerin, so on and so forth. Shear thinning materials, on the other hand, show a constant viscosity in a limit of low shear rate, but the viscosity later decreases, and it may happen so that the viscosity may reach a constant plateau in the limit of very high shear rates as well. So these materials are also known as pseudoplastic materials, and these materials are typically dilute emulsions, polymer solutions, polymer melt, suspensions, dilute colloidal solutions, etc., etc. Then we have shear thickening materials. Shear thickening materials are typically colloidal suspensions or particulate suspensions beyond 30 weight percent, 30 volume percent. And what is observed is that in the limit of very small shear rate, a constant viscosity plateau is observed. And then these materials undergo a very strong shear thinning behavior. However, then at certain stress or shear rate, they show a very sharp increase in viscosity. Sometimes this viscosity increase is continuous, sometimes this viscosity increase is discontinuous. One of the proposals for this shear thickening behavior is this hydrocluster formation. Other proposal is essentially stress-induced jamming. Of course, the subject of shear thickening is very broad, and this is out of kind of present focus, but there are, the debate still goes on whether the shear thickening is because of these hydroclusters or stress-induced jamming. The system which is interest to us is, of course, yield stress material, which we, of course, we call either as Bingham plastic material or Hershey-Brinkley material. And typical example is a toothpaste, cosmetic cream, tomato ketchup, mayonnaise, and various kinds of materials in that particular category, wherein, unless some threshold stress is applied to material, material does not flow. And when material flows, if this particular slope remains constant, slope remaining constant means its viscosity decreases weakly as a function of shear rate. You essentially get a Bingham model. And if this viscosity decreases very sharply, then we get Herschel-Berkeley model. So these are the typical constitutive relations that we have proposed. These are very empirical constitutive relationships. And as I said, that there is no kind of, at least to my understanding, first principle basis to constitutive relationship. Constitutive relationships are always very smart guesses that tend to model the experimental behavior well. Now, the next important aspect that we must understand before talking about any kind of topic of rheology is what is concept of relaxation time. And the relaxation time, in simplest words, can be represented as it is the time over which material stores energy. So we know that if we actually kind of deform liquid, then that deformation kind of suddenly gets dissipated within liquid, and liquid attains its equilibrium state very, very fast, which means that the liquid store energy over negligible time scale compared to our observation time scale. On the other hand, if you have solids, which we call as ideal solids, which are perfect crystals, they do not have any energy dissipation mechanism. So therefore, unless that crystal remains intact, they store energy over infinite time scale. All right. So I'm just kind of giving one example over here of a crystal. So in case of crystal, relaxation time essentially tends to infinity. It is practically infinite. On the other hand, for liquids, the relaxation time is very small compared to our observation time scales. If there are such liquids whose relaxation time is greater than our observation time scales, then this, we do not call it liquid, but we call it, or viscous liquid, we call it viscoelastic liquid. Another very important characteristic of elastic solid is their constitutive relationship. in elastic solids, stress directly proportional to strain with modulus as a proportionality constant. On the other hand, for viscous liquids, stress is proportional to rate of strain with viscosity as a constant of proportionality. So this particular aspect, that in case of stress, in case of solids, stress is proportional to strain, while in case of liquids, stress is proportional to strain rate, has been very cleverly used by rheologists to obtain information about the materials by applying oscillatory flow field. So what is typically done in any rheological experiment, usually in order to obtain signature behavior of a material, what is always done is material is subjected to sinusoidal oscillatory flow field. So if you induce gamma is equal to gamma zero sine omega t type of oscillations in a material, where gamma zero is so small that it doesn't affect the structure of the material, then of course the strain rate induced in material is essentially derivative of strain. And if material is elastic solid, then the resultant stress will be in phase with strain. However, if material is viscous liquid, then the resultant behavior will be in phase with strain rate. But if material is a viscoelastic material, then the response will be intermediate, which means that the stress response can be resolved into response proportional to strain and response proportional to strain rate, which means that if we actually take magnitude of response proportional to strain and divide it by magnitude of strain, then what we get is known as elastic modulus. On the other hand, if we take the magnitude of stress which is proportional to strain rate or is in phase with strain rate and divide that by magnitude of strain which was applied, what we get is something called viscous modulus. The ratio of viscous modulus to elastic modulus is known as tan delta, or the loss tangent, and both G prime and G double prime, or any of these two, G prime, G double prime and tan delta, are very, very frequently used by rheologists to understand the signature behavior of the material. However, we are not talking about general viscoelasticity, we are talking about yield stress materials, so I'll not go into details of this. What we shall simply do is, so then I'll spend some time on rheometry, because rheometry is a very important aspect when it comes to measurement of yield stress is concerned. Typically, there are two types of rheometers. One is pressure flow, other one is drag flow. In case of pressure flow, flow is generated by applying pressure across the closed channel, and typical shear rates that are generated in pressure flow are between 100 and 1000 per second. An example of pressure flow rheometer is capillary rheometer. On the other hand, the drag flow rheometer is the one when one boundary is stationary and other boundary is moved with respect to that stationary boundary when the material, the fluid or the system, the material being studied is in between these two boundaries. The shear rate that kind of, which can be obtained, a shear rate that can be achieved in drag flow rheometers is usually below 100 per second. The lower range can be, literally speaking, 10 raised to minus 6 per seconds, or even lower depending upon the patience of the person who is doing the experiment. The typical geometries which are used for drag flow rheometer are conant plate rheometer, parallel plate rheometer and concentric cylinder rheometer. Now let's go to the drag flow rheometer. The typical capillary rheometer has a barrel. You can see that this is a barrel, this is a piston, and there is a small capillary over here. And what is done is that material is kept in this particular barrel and piston is pushed down. The material is in kind of liquid state or viscoelastic state. It essentially comes out of the barrel, it comes out of the capillary. In the capillary, depending upon the pressure drop across the capillary, has wall shear stress given by this particular relationship. On the other hand, if we measure the flow rate of material that is coming out, then we can relate that flow rate to shear rate. So this gives us shear rate simply by measuring flow rate. This gives us stress at the wall by simply measuring the pressure drop. This particular rheometer can be operated in stress controlled fashion or strain controlled fashion. In stress controlled fashion, you simply kind of keep some kind of constant weight across on top of this particular piston, so that the pressure drop is fixed and you get stress control rheometer. In case of strain control rheometer, you control movement, downward movement of this particular piston by some motor. So if you control the velocity of this particular piston, you essentially get strain control rheometer. There is benefit of having both the control system in these kinds of systems. If a yielding process is stress controlled, then of course it's very important that you kind of have stress control rheometer. Otherwise, usual rheometers are all strain controlled rheometers. When it comes to drag flow rheometers, we also again have stress control rheometers and strain control rheometers. In any typical drag flow rheometer, what we have is bottom plate is stationary, top plate can be rotated, and either you apply torque to system and measure the displacement, or you apply displacement to the system and measure the torque. All right. If torque is applied, it becomes stress controlled rheometer. If displacement is applied, it becomes strain controlled rheometer. So usually the low cost rheometers available in market are all stress controlled rheometers. Strain controlled rheometers are comparatively rare. They are extremely expensive because controlling strain is not that easy. So usually what we are available in market are primarily stress controlled rheometers. So there are three types of geometries: parallel plate geometry, cone and plate geometry, and concentric cylinder geometry. And in case of parallel plate geometry, you essentially have bottom plate stationary, top plate is moved with certain angular velocity, and the torque applied to the system can be related to the stress by this particular expression. This is parallel plate. Same thing goes with cone and plate, wherein you essentially have a cone. The advantage of having a cone and plate geometry compared to parallel plate geometry is that as a function of radial distance, the shear rate in cone and plate rheometer or cone and plate geometry remains constant. On the other hand, in case of parallel plate geometry, as a function of radius, the shear rate changes, and which is not a very desirable thing. So therefore, if possible, always cone and plate rheometer is preferred over parallel plate rheometer. Again, torque can be related to shear stress in this particular case as well. In case of concentric cylinder, you have inner cylinder and you have outer cylinder, and material is essentially in between inner and outer cylinder. And usually the inner cylinder is rotated, but in some cases even outer cylinder can also be rotated. So in many rheology books you will find what are the relationship between how the shear rate is measured, how the shear stress is measured in all these devices, and how to obtain the rheological parameters such as viscosity or first normal stress coefficient, so and so forth. All right. So this is as far as brief about the rheometry is concerned. Now let us begin with the fantastic materials that we observe in our day-to-day life. So when he studies fluid mechanics in the first year or second year of engineering curriculum, or similarly in physics curriculum, fluid is defined as that material that deforms under infinitesimally, that flows under infinitesimal stress. However, in our day-to-day life, we come across so many materials such as first toothpaste, hair gel, this is grease, this is wheat dough, some kind of a washing cream, jam, ice cream, cosmetic creams, various kinds of pharmaceutical creams, and variety of industrial pastry materials. We observe that these materials simply do not flow, even significant amount of finite stress is applied to them. Only after subjecting these particular materials to their respective critical stresses or threshold stresses, only then you can actually make this particular material flow. And this particular aspect was first recognized by the gentleman called Bingham around 101 years back. Actually, last year we celebrated the centenary of this paper published by Bingham, So Bingham published this paper called An Investigation of the Laws of Plastic Flow in 1916, which essentially introduced the concept of yield stress. He actually carried out series of experiments in capillaries of different sizes with clay suspension, where clay is kaolin. And Bingham observed that the pressure needed to flow these materials must exceed a critical value. And then Bingham distinguished the plastic behavior from viscous behavior by requirement that the former have finite friction, while the latter, which is the viscous materials, essentially kind of have infinitesimal friction, which needs to be overcome in order to make these materials flow. So the model that actually Bingham proposed is as follows, that viscosity is practically infinity below this particular critical stress, which we will now call as yield stress. On the other hand, when this particular yield stress is overcome, material flows in this particular fashion. And many times people say that in case of Bingham fluid, since this mu is constant, viscosity is constant, but no, viscosity is not constant. Keep in mind that viscosity is not slope of shear stress shear rate curve. It is essentially any point on shear stress shear rate curve, it is slope of that point and origin. All right, this is viscosity. Slope of this curve is not viscosity. So therefore, in case of Bingham model, very naturally material shows weak shear thinning behavior. However, if shear thinning behavior shown by materials is not represented by constant value of this particular mu, but if this mu decreases with increasing shear rate, then what we get is called Herschel-Bulkley model. And very interestingly, many, many soft materials beautifully show very close prediction or very close resemblance to Herschel-Bulkley behavior under certain circumstances. This certain circumstances is a very important word, and we'll come to discussion of this particular aspect, under which circumstances Herschel-Bulkley's behavior is observed. But many, many aspects are not kind of shown well by many, many experimental observations, are not very nicely predicted by this either Bingham or Herschel-Bulkley model, which demands a different kind of modeling approaches, which we will actually kind of look at later in this particular discussion. Okay, so very recently, as I said, that we had this being celebrated centenary of Bingham, and Philippe Pousseau, who is a very leading rheologist, he actually wrote an editorial of a special issue of Rheologic Acta, wherein he mentioned that only in rheology journals also you see a very strong increase in publications devoted to yield stress materials. All right. So please note that this particular slide is only associated with rheology journals such as Journal of Non-Newtonian Fluid Mechanics, Rheologic Acta, and Journal of Rheology. If you count all the other journals, then this number will probably be order of magnitude larger. Okay. So now, before actually moving to seeing what kind of rheological observations are shown by yield stress materials, what we shall do is we will kind of take a brief overview of what kind of microscopic structure leads to yield stress behavior. And of course, the most favorite diagram for anybody is this hard sphere phase diagram, wherein all of us know that below 50% of volume fraction, material is in fluid state. Keep in mind that these particles are hard sphere particles, which means that unless they touch each other, there is absolutely no interaction between these particles with each other. And if beyond 50%, if we slowly increase the volume fraction, then up to 54%, what we get is the biphasic region where fluid and crystal coexist with each other. However, beyond 54%, the material essentially kinds of crystallizes in face center cubic fashion, and as the concentration is further increased, the crystal essentially becomes more and more compact, and you cannot get more than 74% of the volume fraction with this crystal structure. now, theoretically speaking, why I'm saying theoretically, you will come to know in a moment, but if we kind of increase volume fraction rapidly enough so as to avoid this crystallization, nucleation, which is shown over here, then you can actually, in principle, get into something called supercooled region. And this supercooled region exists between 50% to around 58%. Now, keep in mind that this supercooled region is not equilibrium part. The equilibrium line of this particular phase diagram, this is the equilibrium line. Okay, so you can call this as phase. This is not phase. These are simply the states of the matter. But you increase volume fraction fast enough so that one gets into the supercooled region, and then beyond 58%, one gets into the glassy region. All right. So certainly the material in the glassy region show yield stress, which we'll see that behave their behavior in a while in after few slides. But material in supercooled liquid also shows very peculiar behaviors, which we'll also will discuss in later slides. The diagram that I'm showing you here, picture that I'm showing over here, is from Tom Mason's group from UCLA, wherein he has actually, this is micrometer by the way, 2.3 micrometer PMMA collides in density matched solvent, and you essentially have slight polydispersity is visible over here, and you can see the material is actually in the glassy state over here. So as I said that if you increase volume fraction fast enough, you get into supercooled region. But this is not so straightforward if particles are borodispersed. So typically around 10% of polydispersity is induced to avoid crystallization. If you induce this much of polydispersity, then you get into such a domain where you can actually get a supercooled region, and with further increase in volume fraction, you can get into a glassy region. The other issue associated, other difficulty associated with working with these spherically shaped particles is possibility to obtain real Hart-Sphere interactions. Real Hart-Sphere interactions are very difficult to obtain. So usually in order to obtain repulsion among the particles so that particles do not attract, because if particles attract each other, then we get into some different scenarios which will come to in a moment. So what is usually done is that short polymer brushes are chemically attached to the particle, which introduce steric stabilization that result in near Hart-Sphere interactions. Okay, so this is one very popular way of inducing Hart-Sphere interaction among the particles. On the other hand, if you are actually kind of, if you have any metallic particles, or even in case of certain organic particles that are stabilized by surfactant systems, controlling pH may lead to wonderful repulsive interactions. Particularly, we know that any material which is chargeable, which can acquire charge, is negatively charged in the limit of very high pH. On the other hand, that material becomes positively charged in the limit of very low pH. The pH at which this charge changes is known as point of zero charge. It is a property of that particular material. So therefore, by controlling pH, you can actually manipulate electrostatic interactions, and you can actually have repulsive interactions. Particularly, it is observed that if zeta potential, if magnitude of zeta potential, it may be negative, it may be positive, if it is greater than 40 millivolt, then you can actually have this repulsion over a very long period of time. But no colloidal suspension is kind of equilibrium stable material. Eventually, after very long time, van der Waals interactions will prevail and material will become unstable. So it is, you can only delay that particular process by actually providing this particular electrostatic interactions. Compared to that, polymeric interactions are far more stable. As far as attractive interactions are concerned, many types of interparticle attractive interactions are possible. Van der Waals interaction is always present. Electrostatic interactions between dissimilar charges is present if you actually kind of tune your collides to get dissimilar charges. Depletion interaction can be made possible by adding non-absorbing polymer to the suspension, and then hydrophobic and hydrophilic interactions can be obtained by tuning the material accordingly. So typically what you get is this very nice behaviors, which can be kind of divided into three parts, particularly when it comes to particulate matter. One is gel, other one is attractive glass, then it's repulsive glass. Of course, the most boring as far as our work is concerned is liquid. So on vertical axis here, we plot interaction energy. Keep in mind that this interaction energy is close to zero or repulsive in this particular region, while it is attractive in this particular region. All right. So influence of temperature is, of course, in the opposite direction. If you increase temperature, you essentially kind of go in this direction. If you decrease temperature, you go in this direction. The horizontal axis, on the other hand, is volume fraction. So when the interactions are primarily repulsive and volume fraction is low, what you get is liquid state. But by keeping interactions repulsive, if you increase volume fraction to sufficiently high level by avoiding crystallization, what you get is something called repulsive glass. All right. Now, in that repulsive glass, by some way of tuning it, if you can actually induce attractions, then repulsive glass can be turned into attractive glass. And in that attractive glass, if you essentially kind of change its volume fraction, what you get is gel. You can also go from liquid to gel by simply increasing the attractive interactions. All right. So all these materials, gels, attractive glasses, and repulsive glasses, are very, very important materials from the soft condensed matter physics point of view, as well as its applications point of view. While this discussion in theory appears very nice and straightforward, forget about distinguishing repulsive glasses and attractive glasses. Even distinguishing what are gels and what are glasses is also very difficult. So subject is very much evolving. A lot of scattering microscopic as well as rheological techniques are being used to distinguish signatures of repulsive glass, attractive glass, gel, as well as liquid. All right. Now we essentially move to some gel-like systems. Typically, colloidal gels, not necessarily, not always, but many times, colloidal gels have fractal structure. What do you mean by fractal structure? Their mass shows this kind of relationship on the radius. All right. Where this df is known as fractal dimension, and this is typically less than 3. 3 is a typical three-dimensional body. All right. So if this, and this df is typically observed to be between 1.5 to 2.3. This is the typical range of this df is observed. In some cases, this fractal dimension can be less than 1.3 or less than 1.5. In some cases, it can be very high as well. All right. Obviously, it cannot exceed 3. If it approaches 3, then you do not have a fractal structure, but you have a three-dimensional body. Two examples are given over here. One is from George Petikidis' group, which actually shows a depletion gel at intermediate volume fraction of 44%. And the interaction energy, he has able to tune this interaction energy, it comes out to be around minus 16 kT. On the other hand, this particular picture is from Tom Mason's group, which shows a suspension of dyed PMMA particles, which again have typically around 1 micrometer to 2 micrometer radius. Now, depending upon how strong is the ability of the particles to form a bond, you essentially get two typical types of fractal structures. When attractive interactions are strong enough, a particle needs fewer collisions before forming an interparticle bond, which leads to some kind of an open structure. And this particular structure is known as diffusion limited crustal aggregation, which has fractal dimension between 1.7 to 1.9. On the other hand, if the attractive interactions are not strong, then particle essentially collides many times before a bond is formed. In that case, the structure is more compact, and the structure is then considered to be formed by reaction limited cluster aggregation, and you essentially get the fractal dimension which is higher, which means compact structure between 2 and 2.1. Usually what is observed is that gel consolidates as a function of time, which means that gel becomes stronger and stronger as a function of time. Usually it is observed. It is not necessary that it will always be the case. So what happens is that one of the kind of proposals from David White's group, as far as this consolidation of gel is concerned or stiffening of gel is concerned, is that as a function of time, the coarsening of the microstructure occurs through bond restructuring. So in that case, various particles move to more favorable positions so as to form more and more stronger bonds. And stronger the bond is, with same bond density, because particle density is same, you essentially get increase in relaxation time as well as modulus as a function of time. And that actually leads to increase in gel strength, or you can say that gel is aging or gel is stiffening. All right. So this is typically happens in case of gel. This gel stiffening has a very strong influence on yield stress behavior of the gels, which we'll come to in a while. As far as gels are concerned, the gravitational effects may intervene, and what may happen is that because of gravity, the gel may start becoming more and more dense at the bottom and lean at the top. In sometimes this particular process may occur catastrophically, wherein the whole gel collapses within a very short period of time. This is as far as gels are concerned. In many soft glassy materials, the jamming of constituents also leads to this particular kind of soft solid like behavior. See, bottom line of this whole discussion is that which all are these microstructures that lead to semi-solid like state, because semi-solid like state is the one that undergoes yielding process. All right, so first we talked about repulsive glasses, then we talked about gels, and now we'll talk about various kinds of multiphase systems. Particularly in case of emulsions, we have liquid in liquid. In case of foams, we have gas in liquid. And in case of microgel, we have solid in some kind of a liquid state. And jamming of the dispersed particles also leads to glassy state. And we'll essentially kind of discuss the structure of these particular systems in a moment. So at low concentrations, they are all in liquid state. And they are in low concentration, all these dispersed particles acquire their equilibrium shapes. However, as the concentration increases, they start jamming. They cannot acquire their equilibrium shapes. So they are now essentially moved away from equilibrium. And then you essentially have an energy landscape system. Some kind of system is kinetically constrained in some domains of that energy landscape. And the real equilibrium state, real free energy state, may be at some really far place. And then system essentially evolves to find that equilibrium state. And while doing that, all these jammed systems undergo restructuring. In some cases, that restructuring is fast. In some cases, that restructuring is so slow that we cannot experimentally observe it over practical time scales. So one of the kind of typical examples, of course, is foams, wherein you can see that these gas bubbles are trapped by liquid film. And just by virtue of this, it gives it a stiff kind of a backbone, and foams are the typical materials that show yield stress behavior. Then we have concentrated emulsion systems. You can see that the in case of concentrated emulsions, particularly in this case, the volume fraction of the dispersed phase could be more than 85-90%, and you can see that all the drops are polygonal in shape. And these polygons then kind of form a load-bearing structure, and they do not undergo flow under application of infinitesimal stress. A finite stress is needed then in order to kind of break this particular structure, and you essentially have concentrated emulsion as yield stress materials. The case of microgel paste is something very interesting. So microgel pastes are typically polymeric gels. These are hydrogels. The hydrogels, the smallest particle of the hydrogels in dry form is in micron length scale. So what happens is that if you put these micron size dry particles in a liquid which swells these particle particles, and if you confine them to a very small domain, then what happens is that all these particles, in principle, let's kind of assume that after swelling, these particles will acquire a spherical shape. But if their concentration is more than 64%, or in some case actually in 74% or something like that, then these particles will not acquire spherical shape, but these particles will get deformed. And you can see here a microgel paste where their surfaces are flat. So in case of microgel paste, volume fraction of particles approaching 100% is not uncommon. You can actually have, you can put these particular particles in such a fashion in liquid so that they swell and span entire volume, approaching 100% volume, and people actually have been able to kind of do these kinds of experiments. You can tune the swelling capacity of the hydrogels by changing temperature. So very interestingly, you can then change the volume fraction of these microgel pastes by tuning temperature, and many studies are available in literature that actually kind of show that behavior. The microgel paste happens to be a very, very potent academic system to understand yield stress behavior, and we will kind of look at some of the rheological observations on microgel pastes a little later. Aqueous nanoclay suspensions is also a very important system, not just from academic point of view, but it has huge industrial applications. If you go to any nanoscale, if you go to any clay manufacturing company's website, then you will find huge applications, starting from petroleum, petrochemical, pharmaceutical, agrochemical, civil engineering, paint, polymer. You name an industry and you will find that these nanoclay suspensions are used. So typically what happens in this case of the specific example I'm giving here is for laponite, but laponite is just an example. What I'm saying is true for any nanoclay, that its faces are always negatively charged in aqueous system, and its edge is most of the times positively charged. So when you disperse this particular kind of clay particles in water, with time they essentially form some kind of fractal gel that looks like this, and they become very, very stiff. So typically 1 to 5% or in some cases 10% of 10 volume percent of 1% to 10 volume percent of clay in water can give that water not just significant stiffness, but typically in case of laponite, it is observed that 1 volume percent of laponite in 99 volume percent of water within few days converts water from a free flowing liquid to a soft solid that can sustain its own weight. All right, so these are very kind of ideal yield stress materials on one hand. On the other hand, they have huge applications, so therefore understanding their behavior is also very important. So with this, we come to this particular jamming phase diagram. Many of you must have seen this particular jamming phase diagram. This diagram on the left hand side is due to Sid Nagel and Andrea Liu. The diagram on the right hand side, which actually both diagrams are kind of qualitatively similar, not exactly, but conceptually they are very similar. The diagram on the right hand side is due to David White's group. So the idea over here is essentially as follows. You essentially have jammed material at the core of this particular diagram, and jamming unjamming transition according to this diagram can be carried out by either increasing its temperature, decreasing its density, or increasing the load on it. As far as our work is concerned, our discussion is concerned, we are interested in this line where we will be increasing load in order to cause this jamming to fluid transition, jamming unjamming transition, and this is the yielding process that we're talking about. All right, but keep in mind that this yielding process is merely a part of the big picture which is shown over here. Okay, the diagram of David White's and group is kind of similar in the concept. Okay, wherein you can see here that with increase in stress in this direction, we can actually cause unjamming in the material. This also talks about decrease in density in this particular direction, and increase in temperature, or decrease in interaction attractive interactions in that in this particular direction. All right. So this is a jamming state diagram, jamming phase diagram. The underlying message over here is that the jamming unjamming transition or yielding transition that we are talking about is essentially one aspect of this particular big picture. Pinaki, if you're there.
Yeah.
So please let me know when should I stop for lunch, because this particular slide has further 30 more slides. So I'll simply kind of go on. Whenever you'll ask me to stop, I'll stop.
So maybe we can stop in 5 minutes.
Okay, fine. So I'll just kind of then...
maybe discuss thixotropy and then we can stop.
Yeah. So I'll discuss thixotropy and then stop. Okay. So the important message as far as all these kinds of structural materials are concerned, the structures that we studied that show yield stress behavior, we have still not seen the yield stress behavior of them, but I'm just telling you that all these jammed structures or arrested structures, they lead to semi-solid like state, and we can pretty much imagine that this semi-solid like state will lead to finite yield stress for unjamming or some kind of solid liquid transition to take place. We must keep in mind that all of these structures, I'm not even kind of making an exception or being politically correct saying most of the structures, I'm saying all of these structures which are in semi-solid state are thermodynamically out of equilibrium states. All right. So what is a typical characteristic feature of any thermodynamically out of equilibrium state? A typical feature of any thermodynamically out of equilibrium state is that it always undergoes evolution as a function of time, because that material, if it is not in thermodynamic equilibrium, simply cannot stay quiet at whatever state it is in. That material always wants to achieve the thermodynamic equilibrium state. However, many times the kinetic constraints simply do not allow it to kind of achieve that thermodynamic equilibrium state. And under such circumstances, the material undergoes some microscopic motion of structural rearrangement. These microscopic motions occur because of thermal energy, and either they can occur because of thermal energy or they may occur sometimes because of some kind of residual stresses, but we'll primarily focus on thermal energy. And they essentially kind of try to lower their energy, free energy, as a function of time. Many times this particular progress of material from any out of equilibrium state to its thermodynamic equilibrium state is very visible, and you can see that as a function of time properties of material change very visibly. In some cases this change is so subtle that macroscopically we are not able to kind of record any property change over measurable time or over any practical time scales. Particularly when this particular change in material behavior is very apparent or very vivid, material shows behavior which actually is shown in this particular slide, and in that case material is called as thixotropic material. All right. So thixotropy is a property wherein viscosity of material decreases continuously as a function of time under application of deformation field, but if kept under quiescent condition or very weak deformation field condition, the material structure recovers as a function of time. So this is a classic definition of thixotropy. Bottom line is that under quiescent condition, material wants to acquire the lowest or lower and lower free energy states. So therefore, material essentially evolves by forming low energy structures. This is called physical aging. And application of deformation field essentially breaks down that particular structure in order to reduce viscosity or reduce stiffness of that particular material. This behavior is essentially leads to thixotropy. So typically what happens is that if we apply shear rate, then when you apply shear rate, material takes a high stress path because structure is still intact. As the shear rate gets increased, the structure breaks down. So when you come back, it takes a low stress path because structure is not able to recover in this particular time span. So therefore, you get this particular loop. This is typically known as thixotropic loop, and you can have various variants of thixotropic loops possible. The last figure I'm showing over here shows a very peculiar behavior. Many times, in very much thixotropic behavior, you can see that while going increasing shear rate, you see that material is taking a low stress path, while decreasing shear rate, material takes a high stress path. Some people may call this behavior as rheopectic behavior, but keep in mind, this is not rheopectic behavior. This is also a thixotropic behavior, because the magnitude of applied shear is so small that material can cover or can edge even though it's applied stress is, deformation field is applied, and when deformation field is reduced, it continues to edge. So therefore, you get a loop in different direction. Rheopecticity is a property wherein material's viscosity increases because of applied shear rate. Here, material's viscosity is not increasing because of applied shear rate. It is increasing because of aging, because you have not sufficient, if you have not applied sufficient amount of deformation field. So we must understand these subtle differences while dealing with thixotropic fluids. And whatever is to be said in this particular slide, I have already said it. So the point is that the most of the thixotropic, I should say all of the yield stress materials are thermodynamically out of equilibrium materials, but where the evolution of structure is very vivid, we call these materials thixotropic. And this particular vivid display of property evolution is known as physical aging. In principle, the structure evolved during quiescent conditions can be reversed by applying deformation field. So this particular phenomenon is known as mechanical rejuvenation. Why I'm saying in principle? Because in some cases, applied deformation field takes the system to such locations of energy landscape where you essentially kind of, which are otherwise not kind of achievable in the simple evolution. Those are very complex situations and will not kind of deal with those situations. But we will kind of consider a very linear dynamics over here, that aging evolves, regeneration destroys. And very importantly, is that this very fact that you can tune the material by tuning how much deformation field is to be applied can be used to optimize mechanical properties of these soft glassy materials. All right. I think Pinaki, let's kind of stop here. I'll start with the rheological behavior of soft materials in the next 1 hour, and in the final 1 hour, I'll discuss all the modeling approaches.
So I had one quick question. So when you were discussing these thixotropic materials, can you give some examples of the different curves that you showed?
Just a second.
So that people can understand what kind of materials have.
Okay. Can we just wait for 2 o'clock? I have. These are just schematics. I'll be showing you the direct experimental behavior and what material I'm talking about.
Fine. Okay, so Yogesh, thanks very much for a nice introduction to this soft glass rheology. So we'll now break for lunch and then we'll reconvene at around 2.